The Biscuit Podcast is a proud partner of the 2019 Mustache Classic Ice Hockey Outing, benefiting men's cancer and suicide prevention in cooperation with the Movember Foundation on November 16th, 2019 at Danbury Arena in Danbury, Connecticut. We are joined in partnership by Champion Elevator, Roosters, Hockey Wax, Boost Oxygen, Sprig, CBD, Soda, 2 for Roughing Designs. Just saw their designs they're doing for the event. Pretty sick, boys. Grand Supply Company, the Danbury Hat Tricks, who said they were going to send me a shirt a couple months ago and then didn't. I don't know what's up with that, but and TK's American Cafe. Hit the Mustache Classic up on Instagram for further information. The logo, I think it's just under Mustache Classic, but the logo looks like the Pringles guy. And couldn't be happier to help out with the event, guys, and look into it, see how you can help, donate, or go to the event. And we're proud to be working with those guys. Also proud to be working with the great people over at Hairless Ape Conspiracies. Go over there. It's a veteran-owned, veteran-operated clothing company, and I wear their shirts all the time. Sam Burns has been on the show. Go listen to his episode. I love everything they do over at Hairless Ape. Use the promo code BISCUIT10 at checkout and save yourself 10% off. You're welcome. Also, this podcast is brought to you by ParkersPlatoon.org. That's Stanley Cup champion Scott Parker's nonprofit organization to help one veteran at a time. Go to the website, see how you can help, click donate. Every dollar counts. Thank you, guys. And last but not least, hockeyfights.com. That's hockeyfights.com, where you go to watch hockey fights. Ladies and gentlemen, we continue on to the Atlantic Division with my main man, Farmer Rob. Let's go.
Now Probert got the right hand free.
He's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nylund, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt!
It's old-time hockey, the way you're supposed to play. You throw a little lumber if a guy gets in your way. You play like Gordie Howe or Eddie fucking Shore. We can't all be Gretzky's, the loser Bobby Orr's.
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts, it's the Biscuit. It's the Biscuit.
Damn it! Their goal regulation size are what?
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. There's a country we'll stop working on, so Batman's fucking canned.
Hi, everybody. It's the Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, you wanna go?
Yeah, okay. Good luck, man. Good luck to you too, bud.
All right, Biscuit Babies. Fan favorite, the one, the only, the Farmer Rob is in the house. How we doing, Farmer Rob?
Pretty good, buddy. Pretty good.
Now, I got to start off here because, you know, all this stuff in Canada now. How many times have you done brown face?
I never. I can go on the record and say that that's never happened, but never happened.
Not hard to answer, is it?
No, it's not a hard one at all for me, anyways.
We got our president doing orange face, your guys' chancellor or whatever he is doing brown face. Times are strange, huh?
Yeah, that's a different one for sure.
Well, it's you know, one of the best times of the year coming up, Farmer Rob. Hockey season's about to start. You know, you're quite the Maple Leaf fan. It's been getting more and more exciting in Toronto, and you got to be getting pumped for the season start, right?
Well, yes and no. I mean, I've seen a lot of seasons come and go, so, you know, the first month of the season is kind of a warm-up period for me. I don't get too cranked up till we get a little deeper into the season, to be honest. I mean, I am looking forward to watching some meaningful games, though, for sure.
Yeah,
for
man, sure. Definitely, and it'll be good, you know, being a Leafs fan, just getting started, because all you hear about is contracts and this and that, so it'll be good to get the puck down the ice and just start playing some games.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And talk about the games rather than all the other goals with it, so for sure.
That's got to be, I mean, that's a lot different, you know, that Canadian market than what, say, I'm used to in Ohio, where, you know, I have to go find the hockey news. It's not out there where these guys are going to eat and having too many beers and things like that.
Yeah, no, the media scrutiny on the players is terrible in Toronto, actually. There's certain players that can thrive in that environment, and then certain players that don't. And you're under the spotlight 12 months of the year.
Yeah.
And everything you do and everywhere you go, it seems that it's on social media or just the mainstream media, and you're but it's a good thing and a bad thing. I mean, if you're on a team in Toronto that succeeds and does well, that
king,
carries you for the rest of your life.
Yeah, king, but king also, of the world.
If you're a guy they turn on and they don't like, it can be pretty ugly and hard on the guy's career for sure.
Yeah, if you get Phil Kessel out of there.
Yeah, well, and when I was a young guy, I remember there was a real good defenseman, an all-star defenseman, Larry Murphy.
Yeah.
And fans turned on him, and just they wrote him right out of town. And, he went on to Detroit, won a couple of cups. I think he's in the Hall of Fame. I mean, that's just the market. That's just the way she goes.
That is. And, you know, we talked a little bit before the show about, you know, maybe a guy who was going to get that C and kind of things going on with him. And, you know, we're not going to get into that here now because we're here to get into the division, but it's got to be good for that. You know, it's hard for that team right now because it's a historic team and all these contracts. And you know, now a guy who was probably going to wear the captaincy, and we'll see where they go from there. And I wanted to ask you because down here we got a tremendous amount of rain this season, and a lot of farmers actually had to get bailed out from the government. You're not a crop guy, but how was everything farming wise for you guys this year?
Actually, we had a really wet and cold, cool spring. We were behind. We do plant some crops, and we were in our area here in southern Ontario. Some I would say 3 weeks behind.
Yeah.
For the most part, and we grow a lot of hay. We make feed for the cattle, and we're usually trying to be started on the 1st of June. And I think we didn't get started till the 10th, and we really had nothing done to speak of till the middle of the month. So
it was
lots of rain and good weather since. Like we can't complain about the season.
Yeah, it was.
Summer's been good.
It was so wet down here in the spring that they couldn't even begin to do what they usually do, like you said, for at least 3 weeks. So they were starting to shake in their boots a little bit there. Finally cleared up, and I think some of the agriculture.
I follow farmers on Twitter from all over the United States, and there was a lot of flooding, and it looks like the yields for all the cash crops are going to be way off this year from what I can see. But no, it was a strange spring for sure. Very wet, very wet.
Well, Farmer Rob, we're going to switch it up. I usually start from the bottom and go to the top. You know, we'll mix it up a little bit here. I want to hear who you got, you know, who you think is going to win the Atlantic this year. We're going to work our way down to the bottom of the barrel. And I would assume you probably have the same person that I got in first place because it seems like a no-brainer, really. But who do you got sitting on top?
Well, I got Tampa for sure. Until another team steps up, I mean they're just so loaded and got good goaltending and deep defense, strong forward, and they can score, they can defend, and other than your Blue Jackets threw a bit of a wrench at them there. They're a pretty deep and pretty stacked club. So
that's gotta sting a little bit for them. You know, that has to put a little bit of thorn in their side, I would think, to go in and get swept like that.
Yeah, their pride had to take a bit of beating there, and they're pros, and no one likes to have that happen to them, and they embarrassed themselves. They really did in that playoff series, and no pro athlete ever wants that to happen to them. So
no, and I like they added Patty Maroon on there, give them a little bit of toughness, and for all the pieces that they lost, they've got so many guys that have come up, and you know, Stevie Y guys that were put into that system that they're fine with their younger guys, even if they lose a few pieces here and there.
Yeah, well, their top six, you got Point, Kucherov, Johnson, Stamkos, Palat, what's the other, Jan Gorey.
Yeah,
I mean that's a strong top six, and their blue line, Hedman. What do you got? McDonough, Sergachev.
Now Shattenkirk. And then they have, I mean, arguably the best goalie in the league too, in Vasilevskiy, and he's learned a lot since he's been in. And I agree completely with you. And until they're knocked off, I don't see how you couldn't pick them. It would seem, you know, if anyone's not picking them, it's just to not pick them, basically.
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, we're not talking about the playoffs now. We're just talking about regular season.
That's right.
And they went last season, they ran away with it. I mean, it wasn't even close. So, and with the so little personnel change, I can't see it being any different. And getting points signed the other day, too, was big for them. I mean, that
huge.
If he had a sat out for a bit, that changed things somewhat, too. So.
I think the only thing that might mix him up a little bit is I think that the Atlantic as a whole is a lot stronger this year than it has been in years past. But I still think that they're not leaps and bounds ahead, but they're still better, I think, than everyone.
Oh, yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. Yep, for sure, buddy.
All right, I'm betting our number two is probably the same too. Who you got it to?
Well, I did it last year, and I'm going to do it again. I'm going to take my Leafs for number two.
Yeah, baby, that's who I got.
I they had a great first half last season, a great start to the season, and then they really tailed off in the second half. And you know, there's numerous reasons, but. I still like Toronto, and it's more a byproduct. I like them better than Boston and Florida, so that's why I picked them for second. And they had some holes last season, and some things that came about, like they had a mess. The backup goaltending situation wasn't the best, and I really think that was played into the part. One of the reasons why they lost out in the first round of Boston, if they'd had home ice in that series, it might have made a difference. And Sparks didn't give them any goaltending. And he cost them games. And had they kept McElhinney, and you seen what he did in Carolina, you know, a few extra points here and there, and they could have had that home ice on against Boston. And I'd rather play Bruins in Game 7 in Toronto than in Boston, for sure.
Yeah, I think anybody would agree with that. Playing a Game 7 in Boston is – I don't think any team goes, yeah, let's do that. Let's sign up for that.
No, and the Bruins are, you know, they're a playoff-proven team. They got that veteran core from their cup team, and they went right to the final on the backs of those guys. So
yeah, and Boston's just seemed to have that little bit. They're a little bit nasty, and Toronto didn't have that. And maybe these kids are going to learn a little bit, and they're definitely going to be more well prepared and ready to go. Like you said, they didn't finish a complete season, and then you know had to meet Boston again. And I don't know what it is about McElhinney, man, but he did good in Columbus and Toronto, and he still just gets moved, and he got moved again. There's just something about that guy. Yeah, he can't keep a job.
Well, he got a little bump in pay, and he's in Tampa Bay now, so they certainly solidified their backup position with Curtis there. And I didn't like that move right off the hop. I understand why they did it. You know, Dubas was thinking maybe Sparks would come up. He won the American Hockey League Goalie of the Year the year before.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, in a couple of years, maybe Anderson's contract up, and if he shows something, maybe he hangs around. But I didn't like any of his starts, to be honest with you. So,
is Sparks young?
No, he's I believe he's 27 now.
Oh, okay. So he's on the wrong half of his career.
Yeah, and I think he'd been to 6 or 7 training camps with the Leafs, and he just – that was the first time he made it out of camp. And I mean, he did have a good run in the American Hockey League, but I just found that – he didn't track the puck very well, and rebounds, control, and he moved off in the media a couple of times last year about his teammates, and he basically wrote his ticket out of town once he started yapping. So at the end of the season there, they actually called up Hutchison from the Marlies, and they give him a leave or something, and he wasn't even with the team when the playoffs were on, so... I'm not surprised he's gone, and to be honest, I don't like to be mean, but I'm kind of glad he is. I'm glad they turned the page and didn't try to make it work again this season, because I don't think it would.
So Hutchinson will be number two in that then going forward?
Yeah, he just posted a shutout last night against Montreal, and they had Michael Neuver in camp, but his groin injuries popped up again, and they released him this morning from his PTO. So
poor guy.
It looks like Hutchinson will have the job. And,
now,
hopefully he can get 25 or 30 starts.
Yeah.
And give Anderson a bit of a rest. I mean, the knock on him is he hasn't won the series yet for the Leafs. He hasn't been that goalie taken to the next round. So with a little bit of rest and a little less playing time, that might really benefit Freddie. So
I think that is going to be a trend. You know, I've mentioned it a few times here doing some of these division previews that they're going to try. I think most teams are going to try to get that number two goalie to get 30 games. I mean, that would be ideal to kind of take the load off, you know, 82 games is a lot. I mean, you're not going to see the days where, you know, Brodeur's playing every single game, or, you know, it's that's not going to happen anymore. Or like Grant Fuhr playing 79 games or whatever he did one year.
So, the biggest, you get back-to-back games. Babcock always goes with the backup in the second leg, the second game in the two nights. And you just mentally, I think it gives Anderson a chance to rest. And that's got to be quite a grind.
Yeah.
You know, 82-game season, so.
Does Babcock do that no matter what? If it's back-to-back, he's doing that, so the starter already knows he's not playing that second game?
Yeah, he did that ever since he came to Toronto, or pretty much every time there's a back-to-back. He always addresses to one goalie and then the other.
Now,
it's just style, I guess.
What I really liked in the offseason for Toronto, you know, they beefed up in the right spots, I thought, and especially on defense. I look at their D-core now, man, and it's pretty damn solid. Muzzin and Barry and CeCe and Riley, and I you got to love those top two pairing.
I do, and I am cautious to say that because CeCe had a bit of a tough time in Ottawa. I mean, the whole team had struggled. From what I've seen so far, he looks fine, and I do worry, though. They have puck movers on the blue line, but they don't. As a group, I'm curious to see how they defend.
Yeah,
and that was the biggest problem last season. Is a team, you know, they're trying to run a possession game, and no matter how good you are in the NHL today, there comes a time when you have to defend in your own zone. And this D-core they had last season had a lot of trouble breaking the cycle down low. And like a guy like Jake Gardner's gone, who I didn't like, and defensively he wasn't that good. And he's an analytics darling, and you know he. There's a lot of fans really like Jake, but I certainly wasn't one of them. And Zaitse is gone as well, and I think it was time for him to move on. But I think they're going to miss Ron Haynes. I mean, defensively, I thought Ron last couple seasons had been pretty strong for the Leafs, and I think he helped Morgan Riley elevate his game. And I think the Shabbat kid in Ottawa is going to benefit from having Haynes around, a real pro and an old pro and a good player. But having said that, Barry is fantastic.
Oh, man. I mean, Barry's amazing.
And I felt like in the playoffs last season, I didn't know that he was coming to Toronto or they were even interested, but just watching, you know, here and there, a bit to game and stuff with Colorado, I thought Barry defended pretty well in that series. But, you know, until he comes into Toronto and plays in the system, it'll be interesting to see if they have improved their blue line as much as some people think they have. I tend to sit on the fence on that until I see what they actually do. So time will tell on that. And that is the one part of the Leafs team that has been weak and is weak. There does seem to be some reports out there that their first rounder from two seasons ago, their Sandin, is actually going to make the club this year.
I've seen that.
And if he's ready and steps in, that really solidifies their pair. Because I've seen him a few times in the American Hockey League, and I really like the player.
Is he a big boy?
Ready or not.
Do you know if
he is kind of broke up there?
Is Sandin a big boy?
No, he's not, and that's the thing. And he's still young, and he's still growing, and he's not physical. That isn't his game. He's a puck mover like the rest of the blue line, right?
Right.
So, Travis Dermott is developing slowly and looks pretty solid, but he's out for a while. It looks like maybe late November, I believe.
Oh wow,
so that's a bit of a loss, but anyway, I'd rather have it this time of the year than in the springtime, right?
Yeah, absolutely, and. I mean, if they're going to have all these puck moving guys, I think you got to have a better goalie than Freddie Anderson back there. That's going to be the only thing that will be, you know, a little weird. Is, you know, Columbus has gotten by with that the last few years because Bob was so good in net, but they're going to have to completely change the way they're doing their defense now. And you know, Toronto might have to do that same kind of deal. You know, maybe get in a few less puck moving defensemen and some maybe stay at home defense guys to help out when, you know, if Freddie's letting some in, because Freddie takes a lot of shots.
He does. One thing too, though, we got a full season of Jake Muzzin, who I'm a big fan of. I like that acquisition, and he's rock solid and physical, and I really like him. And him and Barry, both their contracts are up next summer, which is a bit of a concern as a fan. Like I know they won't be able to sign both of them, but I sure hope they can sign at least one of them.
My favorite thing about Tyson Barry is his compete level, man. He just seems like a pure competitor out there. And I think the same thing with Muzzin, too. Those two guys, I don't think – I think they hate losing more than the normal person – the normal pro athlete. I think they have that edge to their game, and I think that's going to – I hope that's infectious in the Toronto locker room. I want Toronto to be good. I like when Toronto's good. I think it's – I'm a huge Matthews guy. You know him being American, and I would like to see this team do well, and I really do think that they will get in second this year. I really do.
Yeah, and I do look at the blueprints for how they're building this club, and it is a bit of an experiment. I don't think a club has ever won a cup that's had so little grit and played so I hate to use the word, but it's a softer game. Like, and time will tell. Like, they have a couple of Russian kids, and they signed some veteran free agents to league minimum contracts, like Kenny Agostino. And it'll be interesting to see how they round out the bottom part of the forward lines to see if they do add a little bit of size or a little bit of grit to their and that is a concern. I mean, the regular season not so much, obviously, but in the playoffs, I thought that St. Louis and Boston were probably as gritty and as physical a club as there was last season, and they both make the finals, right?
Right, right. Yeah, it'll be interesting.
I think you know me as a hockey fan too, and on the other front, I'm a big hockey fights fan, and I always like my Leafs teams to be physical and rough and tough and take care of things. And this club certainly is that way. So.
That's right. That's right.
Time will tell, I guess.
Now, say who you know them getting second. Who would you like to see get third in the Atlantic?
Well, it's not who I like, but I think the Bruins will probably finish third again.
Okay.
I sounded the alarm last year. I was pretty premature. I was talking about how their club was, you know, the veteran leading club with the guys that have been on that cup run, and maybe they'd start to show their age a bit, but they didn't last year.
No, not at all.
And the only thing, maybe Bergeron's getting quite a few miles, and he really does lead that hockey club. I heard the other day, yesterday, I think it was David Krejci's going to miss a bit of time. And I'm not sure about this, but I think I heard something that Chera might be banged up a little bit right to start the season. But I still think they're a solid pick for third. And they did a really nice job. And I wondered about their depth last season. And they find guys. I mean,
I don't know how they did it.
And guys come along like Danton Heinen, and they're the one kid went to Florida this year. I can't think of his name, but
Achari.
And they, you know, guys like Sean Corrali and Kuhlman, and you know, and they made a great trade with Minnesota, picked up Charlie Coyle at the deadline last year. And there's another acquisition that he played well in the playoffs.
What a steal he was, man! What a steal! Coyle was a steal.
Yeah, I like the Donato kid. Actually, I didn't mind the other side of that trade, but at the same time, I've always liked Charlie Coyle's game. Big body, you know, strong in the puck. And he was impressive in the Leafs jersey. I thought he looked great.
So. Absolutely. I think, you know, putting them at third is not – I don't think it's crazy. I'm thinking like you were last year. I think them going, you know, to the Cup and having a few battles there. You know, the Toronto series wasn't easy. Blue Jackets wasn't a pushover series either. And, you know, them battling with St. Louis the way they did too. I think they just have to be – worn out. I mean, you've seen it, it's happened in years past, you know, where you look at Washington last year, they get to the playoffs and like, oh my God, we've been playing hockey for two straight years. And this team, the Bruins are way older than that. And like you said, they've got some injuries and they kind of go as Tuukka goes though, you know, and if Tuukka does well, that team's nigh unbeatable.
Yeah, no, and I kind of crapped all over Halak last spring. I thought fall. I thought his career was on the ropes, and he came in and played very well for the Bruins last winter.
God,
his job as a backup, and he stalled off Tuukka and gave him a bit of a rest. And he had a real good season for the Bruins. I think he was something like 23-10 or 22-11 or something. And that's big. That's big for the Bruins, you know.
And I'll tell you what, Halak has looked amazing this preseason. As far as goaltending in the preseason goes, he's looked incredible. So, I mean, that might shake it right there, and that might put him right in third. I've got him a little bit lower, but not too much lower. And that's only because I think there's a few teams that could stir it up, and I just think maybe that the legs will be a little slower this year, but you never know with Boston, man. They tend to prove people wrong.
No, and they're the kind of club too. They can sneak in on a wild card spot.
Yep.
And just win two rounds just because of those bats they have and the experience they have, you know. And that they're a scary club. I wouldn't want to play the Bruins in the first round, no matter where they finish.
Hell no. Well, that's what
I would really like them not to finish third, because I'm tired of watching them beat the Leafs in the first round. So
maybe that's why I have Florida at three, just so you know you can rest a little bit easy come playoff time. You know, not have to see that goddamn bee on the ice.
That would be nice. That'd be ideal, actually. But I've got Florida picked for it. So
I think Florida's going to be good.
Yeah. I think that, well, I know that their season last year and the season before was, it didn't matter what they did on the ice, their goaltending wasn't there.
Right.
And Bob's going to come in there, and I'm not sure that I would have signed him to the length of contract or the size they did.
No.
But at the same time, he's going to give them solid goaltending for two or three seasons here, and that's what they've really been lacking as a hockey club is solid and stellar goaltending. So.
Yeah, and he's a two-time Vezina Trophy winner. He's, like you said, I think at this point he's earned the length. Do you want to give it to him? No, but I guess Florida, you know, they had to get a goalie, and you know, he's well deserved of it. And with that decor in front of him too, man, they're going to be hard to score on, Florida.
Yeah, the sneaky little move that they signed Strollman as well.
Yeah.
And he's been a solid defenseman for Tampa for a long time, and that's going to help them. And they already had Yandel and my boy Ekblad there. I think we ran him through the ringer last year after the Domi incident. But
yeah, we sure did. That poor guy.
Yeah, Matheson's there too. So, yeah, no, and they made another nice acquisition. It came to me that, what's his name, McCary. They picked him up from the Bruins, and they're deep up front too. I mean, they've got
all the way down
world player in Barkov, eh?
Yeah, all the way down, man. They got, you know, they pick up Brett Connolly, but he's going to be on the third line playing too. And they get that veteran, the kid from Boston, I think they got last year too.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah, and a couple years ago they picked that Owen Tippett out of in the draft. He's on his way this year. I guess we'll see what kind of player he is, but. And the other thing, they got Joel Quenneville now. And,
yeah, that doesn't hurt, does it?
Guys.
Yeah, Ekblad might be as tough as my 4-year-old daughter, but goddamn, he can move the puck.
Yeah, that's right. You know, they're deeper, and I read a stat somewhere, and I could be way off on this, but in one-goal games, or I think they lost 21 goal games or something like that last year.
Yeah.
Like, it was a huge number. And if they had a bit of goaltending,
they win a lot of games.
That would have been enough.
Yep.
You know?
If you look at them, they kind of have that. They kind of have the Maple Leaf model. They're not too damn tough. I mean, going up and down through there. But like you said, and we all know it. I don't mean to beat a dead horse. It seems to be the trend, but it hasn't worked yet.
That's right. And I even hesitate to pick them for fourth, because I went up and down on how great I thought they were last year, and actually kind of like Tampa. Until they show me otherwise, I maybe shouldn't affect them for fourth. But I like what I see too much. One of these years, they're going to bust it.
They have to, right? I'm just such a big Bob guy, and I've seen him carry a team for a decade. I mean, I've seen him do it, and he was no different last year. And he was a head case last year. And he still came in and won a lot of games, and then finally got that playoff series victory under his belt. The way he is off the ice, he's like you said, he's got 3 years easily in him to be an elite goalie. And I think if Bob's happy and he's down there and healthy, I just think they got to be three or four in the Atlantic. I'd be shocked if they're not.
Yeah, that's right. And you'll know firsthand. I mean, there was lots of games, lots of nights over the years where the Jackets had no business being in a hockey game and Bob would win them the game.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, probably more so than not.
And here's the Panthers. They haven't had a goalie like that for, you know, they thought they were getting that in the long run. You know, it just never come together for him there. So.
No, yeah, he gave him a lot of good years, but it was not his best years. But that's the way she goes sometimes.
Yep, no, he's up and Bob's in, and I got him at four. I got him at four.
Now, I have, and I don't know, I keep fighting over this. There's three teams I think that could fall at four. And that's only because I think Boston's going to slide. But I'm going to put, and I should put the Wings there just, you know, because it'll make the wife happy. But I'm not going to. I'm going with the Habs at number four. I don't know why. No rhyme or reason. I just like what they got going on. I think Carey Price is going to pull together, and I think the Habs are going to get there at four.
Well, and I have the Habs at five.
Okay, so see? So I'm not crazy.
And, you know, last season I went up and down both sides of them, and I had to pick for last in the division. And I was vastly underrating what Claude Julien could do. And, you know, Domi came in there and had a hell of a year and led that hockey club from
season. Yes, he did.
And seemed to be the guy that served the drink and set the table for that hockey club. And they got solid goaltending from Price again. And they were 94 points last year. Like any other year, that gets you into the playoffs, right?
Yeah, the only stinker with that is the Metro's usually so crazy that if we're not really giving up that other wild card spot. I think this year that'll change. I think they'll send one from each. And Max Domi just made me a believer, man. He just I believe in the team. I think he's the man.
Yeah. No, he had even a better season than I would have forecasted for him, for sure.
I think he had a better season than he thought he was going to have.
I just hope he'd do well and handle the market. You know, Montreal's a lot like Toronto and that there's a lot of media pressure and the fans are all over you. He seems to thrive with that pressure. So
The only thing that creeps me out about them is I'm not really familiar with a lot of their D guys, but that doesn't mean anything. You know, I'm not watching a ton of Habs games as it goes, but you know, if Weber's healthy, and I'm a big Petrie guy, he's an American. I love his game, but some of these other guys I don't really know too well. But I like this team. I've liked what I've seen through preseason. I like that. I'm a big Kincaid guy. I think he can help Price. You know, give Price a little bit of ease and maybe take some games from him. And I thought Tatar was great last year. Gallagher's a beast. Drouin kind of came back. And then that kid that everybody was stinking on him for drafting, that Kotkaniemi kid, ended up being a pretty decent pick.
Yeah, he was. He was a great pick. And that was another thing. We kind of crapped all over him.
Yeah,
and,
we did.
Yeah, he had a great season.
I shit all over that poor kid, and he ended up being absolutely a third round or a third pick. He was great.
Yeah. The thing that I was impressed with the most about Montreal last season was they were a really hard team to play against. Like, they worked hard.
Yeah.
They never gave up. And you had to really earn your points when you went into Montreal. Like, and I give credit to Julien because he put the system in place and they played that way, you know. They haven't had a whole lot of turnover in players in the season. Other than Andrew Shaw went back to Chicago. That's he was a guy that was one of those that was hard to play against.
Yeah.
But I still can't see them missing him that much. That they're still not going to have a pretty good season this year, I would think.
Yeah, I wish Jordy Benn would have stayed in town just because I thought he gave him – I like watching Jordy play, but are they going to be missing him a whole lot? Probably not. And I like that Paul Byron's still there. Nobody wants to mess with Max Domi. The teams that have been successful recently, as much as people don't want to know, they have a little bit of nasty to them. I think Max can give them that. He might be the sweetest dude off the ice, but, you know, ask Aaron Ekblad what happens on the ice.
Yeah, no, and he's not really well-liked in Toronto. He is on social media a fair bit poking the rivalry between the Leafs and the Habs and saying stuff like this. Montreal's the greatest hockey town in the NHL. And, you know, little things like that. It's just stirring the pot and I mean, I like the kid, so I kind of find it amusing. So.
He's got a little bit of his dad in him, yeah.
Yeah, and Ty himself putting on a Habs jersey.
Woo!
Some of the Leaf fans just wanted right off with that. So.
Ooh, he was doing that just to stir it too. He's probably bored, so he wants to stir it up a little bit.
Oh yeah, he's having fun, and it's good for the rivalry. I mean, I like sitting down watching the Leafs play the Habs, and if it's if there's something on the line and both teams are playing well, it's a lot of fun. So,
well, a rivalry is better when they actually don't like each other. I mean, that's a real thing.
Oh, for sure. And for years, the Leafs have been so poor that, you know, that there was no rivalry. You know, it was a one-sided affair.
Yeah.
Then the Leafs kind of picked up some steam the last couple or three seasons, and then Montreal was struggling a bit, right?
Right.
So I found the games last season to be very entertaining between the two teams.
Yeah, I tune into them when I see you. If I see the Leafs and Habs now, I'm like, I'm checking that one out. It's always a good one. Where are we at, 5 or are we at 6?
Well, I had Montreal at 5. Now, who did you have at 5?
I had Boston going to 5 because I had Habs at 4. Okay. That's right. That's right. So who do you have at 6?
It's a coin toss, but I have Buffalo at 6.
Okay. I thought the same thing. I thought between them and I think the Wings are going to bounce back and have a good year. I just don't think they have the goaltending to get them up there. And I like what Buffalo's got going on. I think they're doing the right things, getting the right pieces in there. When I first did the list, I had Buffalo higher, and then I woke up the next day and hung over and redid my list. I might have had a few too brew sodas. I mean, thought Buffalo was a little better than they might actually be.
I was surprised last season they didn't have a better year, and I guess Phil Housley, it just wasn't a good fit there, I guess.
Yeah.
Would be the best way to put it. And he's gone. And I do like what Botterill has done with the blue line. They've got a pretty solid 6 now.
They sure do.
And picking up Colin Miller over the summer was a good move, and I can't say his name. The kid they got from Chicago for the Nylander's brother.
No one can say his name. Jakahari. I think that's as close as we're getting.
Yeah, and then they have Dahlin, and they picked up Montour from Anaheim at the deadline. It's a sneaky little trade. I like that one. And Ristolainen's still there as well. So like that's as good as 6 is, you know, top to bottom depth-wise as there is in the league.
Is Montour still with them?
Pardon me?
Is Montour still with him? He's a stud.
You broke up again, buddy. Sorry.
Oh, it's my bad, man. I was saying, is Montour still with him? I like his game a lot.
Yes. I did see something the other day that he's with a little minor injury. I don't think it's going to last long. But, yeah, he's still there. And
okay.
Yeah, he's a good puck mover. Southern Ontario boy. I've watched his career close. I like him a lot, actually. But where I see the Sabres' biggest problem, if you look at their depth chart of the forwards, they have Skinner, Eichel, and Reinhardt on the top line.
Yeah.
And it just depends what they get after that. They're kind of a one-line team last year. Now, whether this year, whether Jimmy Vesey can step up and Mittelstedt can gain some ground, find his game. And they did sign Marcus Johansson from with the Bruins there at the end of the season. I just don't think they have the forward depth to really compete in much higher in the division than where I've got them pegged though. So.
Yeah, I don't think if Connor Sheary is, you know, usually playing fourth line on another team, he's on your slot to be in the second line on your team. It, like you said, they might have to get a few other guys going there to. And if Jeff Skinner's got to repeat what he did last year too.
Yeah, and that O'Reilly trade turned out to be a real bomb for them.
Oh God,
they got a lot of, you know, names and like, was it 4 players back? But I mean, they lost that thing. O'Reilly turned, he had quite a year.
So. Woo, he sure did, man.
Yeah, and it makes you wonder too a little bit about the culture around the team and whatnot when he wanted out. And and I don't know any inside stuff, but I just know what he wasn't happy there, and they got him moved and dealt him. And then you see the kind of year he had in St. Louis, and then the Sabres continue to struggle. It makes you wonder whether there isn't something under the veneer there that they've got to work out about that maybe too.
Yeah, pure speculation. I think
everybody likes to point the finger at Jack Eichel.
Right.
Whether he is a problem or not, who knows? But
It's not Jack Eichel doesn't slap the C on himself. You know what I mean? That's not his decision. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Well, it depends where you read on Twitter, but some people think he's the coach and the GM of the team as well.
You hear that all the time, Coach Eichel.
I really like the kid, and I have been my keeper league, he puts up points. And I don't think you could blame him for letting the team down. You know, his on-ice performance is right there. He's one of the better players in the league, I think. So.
Yeah, he's a stud. He's definitely a stud. Who do you have following after Buffalo, then?
I have Detroit, then.
Okay.
Detroit next, then. And it was a toss-up, and I like some of the things the Red Wings are doing. I just think they're a little farther away than than Buffalo. I like the Larkin kid, and I like Mantha, and they got some nice pieces, but they're in a build mode. The very best thing about the Red Wings is they were able to sign Steve Yzerman to be the general manager.
Yeah,
and it's going to take a few years here, but I would be quite surprised if they're not a top contending team within the next 4 or 5 years.
Oh, I think they most certainly will, and it wouldn't shock me if they did very well this year in early first half. And I think maybe because they're going to be young and their defense is going to be suspect, I think at times. But it wouldn't shock me if come Christmas time Detroit's right up there and maybe take a fall off. I don't have a lot of faith in Howard or Bernier, but I have even less faith in the D core they're riding with them, but. In the years to come, you're going to see a kid like Chalowski and Bauer kid or the kid they got from Washington. That kid's a stud too, I think. And then all the other pieces they have coming up, the Hirose kid and, you know, the Bertuzzi, Larkin, Mantha, Anthony Seau. The kids, if they can keep some of these pieces, they're going to be scary, especially with what, you know, Stevie Y is going to bring in because he's an absolute hockey genius.
Yeah, he did quite a good job down in Tampa, and they made a nice little trade. They picked up Adam Ernie out of Tampa, and they have a deep prospect pool. Like, you missed Zadina, and I got that Rasmussen kid who played last season. And
yes.
They signed a kid out of, I think it was Finland, Oliver Kaski.
Uh-huh.
And he was highly, I don't say highly touted, but he was chased by quite a few hockey clubs. He had a bit of a bid more last spring. I think it sounds like he has a chance to stick this fall as well. So, but they're just not there yet.
Right.
They have so many young players that they'll maybe take a step forward this year, but I don't see them making the playoffs.
Well, and I my hat's off to Cronwell for hanging it up too. I think he helped out the team. No disrespect to him, but I think getting other younger players in and him stepping down was the right move. And instead of seeing him out there struggling and, you know, maybe being scratched and whatnot, because some of these younger kids, I think, well, that kid they got from Germany they drafted, that Cedar kid, I watched him play in the Traverse City development tournament there, and he's a stud, and nobody knew who he was. When they picked him, they're going, who the hell's this kid? But that's what Stevie Y does.
Yeah, exactly. I was watching the draft too, and I was digging around, like, well, how low was this kid rated?
Yeah, right.
They really liked him, though, so that. Yeah, and that's the kind of leadership you need. You can't make the easy pick sometimes. You've got to sometimes pick the guy that's not the, you know, everybody's favorite, but he's what you think. You got to make that pick.
I wish the only person I wish would have stayed is Luke Wachowski. He's back down in Tampa. I fucking love him. I know he's kind of not the way the league is, but I loved seeing him. Yeah. He's a Michigan guy. I liked seeing him in the winged wheel, and he always put a smile on our face when he was in the lineup.
Yeah, for sure. Entertaining guy. Back to Cronwell for a bit. He did have a long, you know, a good career.
For sure.
I know Red Wing fans won't like to hear this, but he wasn't really a favorite of mine. And our buddy C. Kyle on Twitter.
He hates him.
he ripped on it pretty good, but
he hates him, dude. He hates him.
Yeah, dirty, and there is some truth to it. I mean, he ran around a little bit, and he would never back it up.
True.
He had a good career, but I can't say much good about him. I don't want my buddy Chris getting mad at me. So.
Chris will come at me, and I'm going to get a bunch of shit from Chris now. I'm going to check my inbox later. It's just going to be a bunch of Cronwell killing somebody and then skating off to the fucking off the bench.
Yeah, no, Chris didn't like him very much. So, but anyway,
who do you have after that?
Well, that'd be the Senators at the last place club. So
yeah,
I like a lot of the names. They got a lot of good young players on the way, and it's just
they'll get there.
Depends if the owner can get out of the way and let the GM do his job.
Who?
Eugene seems to be front and center there with the organization. And you're too young to remember, but I in the 80s there, Harold Ballard was the owner of the Leafs, and it didn't really matter what the product was like on the ice or who was trying to run things. He just made a mess of everything. And Eugene seems to be falling into that pretty handy.
Sticking to it, huh?
I heard yesterday he's got a debt at a casino somewhere, and they're suing him now.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, a rather large nice that too. So, just goes on with Eugene for sure. But he did a nice job. He got some nice pieces. What's his name? Dorian. The GM got some nice pieces back and some trades. And Shabbat, Branson, Tkachuk, Colin White, Batherson. Who am I missing here? Logan Brown,
yep.
A former thing, kid actually played in London here for the Knights that I like a lot, but I mean, they're a long way away.
Yeah.
Those are all young hockey players.
So. Yeah, I like Bobby Ryan. I like Anthony Duclair, but are you going to win a lot of games with these guys? I don't know. I always like tuning into them just because Borowicki's around. I like Brady Tkachuk. I don't know. Yeah. Is Artem Anisimov going to move the needle? I don't know. And, you know, Big Rand's a huge Craig Anderson guy. I don't know why, but he always has been. But I don't – it's – They're going to be last. I think that's just what's going to happen with them. And God bless you, Ottawa fans. I know it's been hard being an Ottawa Senators fan. I know I'm a Blue Jackets fan, but it don't look like it's going to be any easier this year.
No, one nice thing to see the other day, that they got Shabbat locked up. I think it was 8 years.
Yeah, he got paid, huh?
When was the last time a player coming into his prime, or a younger player actually, you know, ended up to stay in Ottawa? So maybe that's the start, though. Their younger players said, hey, you know, this is a good city.
Yeah.
The organization may be on the rebound, and maybe a kid like Chuck doesn't take this first opportunity just to get out of town, right?
Yeah.
And they can build something there. So.
Well, when they drafted him, he said, you know, he's like, I'm happy to be here. Let's go. I think he's excited to kind of change it around. And maybe that young room is going to be beneficial to that team and that franchise.
Yeah, and I mean, you got to start somewhere, and they signed a few vets and picked up, you know, some depth guys over the summer, like I said, my buddy Ron Hainsey there.
Yeah.
But at the same, it's just scary with a young club like that, because things can go wrong as well. So.
Yeah, and like I said earlier, the Atlantic got better too. I mean, as good as Ottawa might have gotten with these pieces and that, I think the rest of the division got exponentially better. You know, so they kind of – maybe on another year it would have been a little more of a needle move, but this year they're still gonna struggle, I think.
Yeah, no, and last season they had to ship a lot of guys out, like Duchesne, and Zingo went down to Columbus. And,
yep.
And Carlson had to move in the summer, and it's just been a lot of upheaval.
Yep.
You know, it wasn't that long ago that club was in the finals. Oh, yeah, it just went so quick for them.
Oh, God, what was it? 3 years ago they went 7 with Pittsburgh, and it was an amazing series, and then it was just chaos after that.
Yeah, it just seems to be one thing after the other, and it's too bad. I the Leafs have had a long-standing rivalry with Ottawa. I like that. I like that, you know, like that anger and that bitterness when they play, and it's. I hope they bounce back quick, so it'll be some fun games to watch again.
Yeah, and I
for any Senators fans in there, so
yeah, I think that the NHL's better too.
Sorry, you broke up again, buddy.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just think the NHL's better when there's more than one good Canadian team.
Yeah, that's right. And we talked last summer there, you know, or last fall. It's scary. They don't draw that well in Ottawa, and Eugene antics. I just would hate to see that team to have ever entertain the thought of moving out of Ottawa. We want more teams in Canada, not less, right? So.
Right. Yeah, that would be heartbreaking to me if that team moved.
Yeah, and I think before that had happened, I think the NHL should step in and find a new owner. It would be a better idea.
Yeah.
But that's just me being mean, because I'm not a big Eugene fan, put it that way.
And I always hear that stadium's like out in the middle of nowhere. Maybe move it into town or something. I don't know.
Yeah, and same as you, I've never been there, but it sounds like you have your downtown core, and then you have your edges of the city, and then you have another smaller city that's kind of technically part of Ottawa is Kanata, but it's really a haul to get out there. It's a long drive, and for people to get there for weeknight games after work and whatnot, it's not ideal, I guess, so.
Yeah, man. Well, Farmer Rob, dude, I appreciate your time, man. And one last question: who's your pick for the cup? Who do you think is going to be at the final?
Final for the cup?
Oh yeah.
Oh, gee, you're really putting me on the
shooting,
spot here.
Shooting from the hip here.
Well, out of the East here, I do like Tampa Bay, but after that the spring they had, it's hard to pick them. You know, I like to see them win a round or two. You know, this spring before I
yeah.
bet much money on the winning. So, you got me here, buddy. I'm always a big Jets fan. They lost a lot of guys over the summer, and I think Buffalo's out, so that's their out too. So I don't know. I hadn't put much thought into that. To look at the Atlantic and go from there. So,
hey, that's fine. When you think of it, just send it to me.
Hey, put me right on the spot here, but no, there's some good teams in the West too, and I off of my head, you know, I like what Vegas has did out there, and they've kept their core. That team that went to the finals a year ago or 2 years ago, I guess. Yep. If I had to pick a club to win the cup right now, that might be my team. It'd be the Golden Knights. So
I don't hate that at all, Farmer Rob, man. Tell everybody where they can find you. I know you're active on Twitter there, and we always have a good time on there. So just let the listeners where they can find you.
Yeah, I'm Farmer Rob 17, and you can find me. Not too hard to find.
All right, man. I always look forward to talking to you, and I appreciate your time, man.
Hey, thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. Anytime, buddy.
All right. Have a good night, Farmer Rob.
You too, buddy. How many cups do